Good morning, everyone. First of all, let me apologize if ever I'm not at my best this morning. I just came from New York together with Ellen. So, also wanted to apologize to some of you who have attended my previous presentations on the Philippine foreign policy. I think this is my 10th international conference presentation on Duterte and the Philippines, which says a lot about international interest in the new Filipino president. I think in the past few months, we have seen two major black swans, game changers. One is in the case of the Philippines with the election of an outside-the-box candidate like Duterte, and of course in the case of US with Donald Trump. I think the world should thank the Philippines because Duterte provides a dry run of what could come under Donald Trump presidency, despite some significant differences between the two leaders. I still think they're very similar in many ways, and that is why we can trace what could happen under US, but also looking at what's happening in the Philippines. I think President Duterte himself also looks forward to the presidency of Donald Trump, and he was among the first person to congratulate Donald Trump and say that in many ways we are alike. We also cuss, although I'm not sure if that's true with Donald Trump. And of course, he said, I'm just a molecule in comparison to Trump, which says a lot about how much respect he has for Donald Trump. So I hope he stops his tirades against the United States. We also now see that domestic shocks could very much affect foreign policy. And I'll show that to you in coming minutes under the case of the Philippines. And I think Duterte is also important for us to understand what could come under Donald Trump, because the debate right now is what kind of Donald Trump are we going to see in the coming 4 years at least. Is it going to be the art of the deal negotiator Donald Trump, who's pragmatic and wants to find peaceful solution to the problems, or is it the aggressive bully and the agitator that we saw during the campaign period? Is my PowerPoint prepared already? I have a PowerPoint actually. Okay, I thought that was supposed. Okay, there was supposed to be a PowerPoint. Let me do it without a PowerPoint. Are you sure I didn't send it? Okay. All right, so over the past 5 years under the Aquino administration, we saw the Philippines transforming its strategy towards China. Previously, under the previous administrations of Ramos and Arroyo, we had more of an equilateral balancing strategy, which was not that different from other ASEAN countries. So in short, we always wanted to hedge our bets. We wanted to maintain strong economic relations with China, while at the same time maintaining strong American military alliance to make sure that we check China's territorial ambitions. But under the Aquino administration, beginning 2012, with the Scarborough Shoal crisis, we saw the Philippines adopting a soft counterbalancing strategy, whereby the Philippines became the most open critic of China, at least in the ASEAN, and became the first country to file an arbitration case against China. As many of you know, the arbitration outcome was much better, at least from the perspective of the Philippines and like-minded countries, than expected. And of course, if the arbitration award came earlier, let's say during the Aquino administration, or under a preferred candidate of his, perhaps Mar Rojas, we would have seen what I metaphorically call the Nicaragua option. Of course, there's significant difference in the ICJ case between Nicaragua and US on one hand and the Philippine case versus China. But what I meant was that if President Aquino was still in power and the arbitration award came out, most likely would have seen an aggressive diplomatic effort by the Philippines to mobilize the international community against China to push for passage of resolution at UN, to push for strong statements in G20 summit, in ASEAN summit, among others. You would have likely also seen the Philippines leveraging the arbitration award to call upon the United States, the Japanese self-defense forces, among others, to also conduct what they call free enough navigation operations. And most likely you would have seen the Philippines openly calling upon Vietnam, Indonesia, and other countries to also put a legal warfare option on the table, if not provide them direct assistance. But the election of Duterte completely changed the game. In fact, there was nothing surprising about Duterte's foreign policy if you bothered to follow his statements over the past 6 months. The fact that I can do it without PowerPoint just shows how many times I've done it. The thing is this. Duterte was very clear from the very time that the campaign period in the Philippines started, the presidential campaign, that he wanted a different course of action when it comes to China. In fact, in around, I think, March or May, a few months before the election proper, he said that if China builds me a train from north to south, I'm willing to shut up on specifically the South China Sea issue. Few days after he won the elections, he said, I want a more independent foreign policy. And he made it clear that what he meant by that is less dependence on the United States. Throughout the campaign period, he made it very clear that he wants more restrictions on American military presence in the Philippines. And we know, as far as Duterte is concerned, he has a long history of resentment towards the United States. And he actually acted upon his resentment. In 2007, he blocked the Balikatan annual joint military exercises between the Philippines and the United States. He never allowed America to conduct drone operations in the Davao airport. So he has a long record of resentment towards the United States. So there was not much surprise about what he did. The problem is that the international media always quoted his most outrageous statements. Like, for instance, when he said, I'm going to take a jet ski, go to the islands and plant a flag, and immediately the impression of the world was, oh, this guy is going to be tough on China. What the world missed was two paragraphs before that, when he said, there's no point in confronting China, that's going to be a suicide for the Philippines, everyone is going to die, what am I, a fool? And then said, maybe I'll just take a jet ski in jest, and I'm going to plant a flag. So I think for people who really followed Duterte over the past few months, beginning the presidential election period, we're not surprised at all by what happened after his inauguration. In fact, few hours after his inauguration, he made it clear, I won't flaunt and I won't taunt the Philippine arbitration case. And over the past few months, we see the Philippines tilting more towards China. I won't call it pivot to China, but at least tilting towards China and distancing itself from the United States. The very fact that President Duterte refused to raise the arbitration award in the ASEAN summit, the very fact that he didn't put the arbitration award at the center of his visit to China, and the fact that he didn't also aggressively mention the arbitration award during his visits to Vietnam, to Indonesia, to Japan, among others, shows that for President Duterte, he always had some doubts about the utility of the arbitration award. In fact, in a March interview with CCTV, he made it very clear that he doubted whether the arbitration strategy was the best way forward for the Philippines to get a comparably favorable strategic outcome. In fact, he said that after, at the end of the day, you cannot implement the arbitration case. It's not enforceable. So what's the point about it? And he's more focused on pushing for engagement with China and getting more development assistance from China. And that's exactly what he did during his visit to China, where he brought home $24 billion in pledges. Nonetheless, does that say that the Philippines is now jumping from one camp to the other? I don't think so, not necessarily. If you look at President Duterte, he has made a lot of very tough statements against the United States over the past few months. But I think that should be put into context. First of all, we know that he has a history of resentment towards the U.S. There's a rumor that his visa was rejected in 2002, and there was a so-called Mayring incident in 2002, whereby FBI agents can just come into Davao and take out a person who blew himself up inside a hotel. So there was already this history of resentment. But I think one of the reasons he was also engaged in tirades against the U.S. was because the Obama administration very explicitly criticized his signature policy of war on drugs and his human rights record. So I think his tirades was also a calibrated way of deterring U.S. from further challenging his number one signature policy and threatening him with possible retaliation or other measures. Now, I think a part of his tirades against U.S. was also a calibrated measure to signal to China that he's a different kind of Filipino president. He's not a proxy of U.S. He's an independent leader. Therefore, he can strike a deal with China. And so he was trying to project independence so that he increases his credibility in any kind of bilateral negotiations with China. So I think this is the context that we have to look at. But up until today, after 3 months of tirades against the United States, after threatening to kick out American special forces from Mindanao, after threatening to scrap bilateral security agreements with the U.S., after threatening to end all joint exercises with the United States, so far we have not seen any confirmation that any of the security agreements with the U.S. will be scrapped. So far, in fact, there has been a new batch of American special forces entering Mindanao. And so far, we have seen that Balikatan or bilateral exercises will continue. I think what Duterte is willing to do here is, as part of a grand bargain, he may renegotiate certain parameters of Philippine-U.S. relations. Probably, he will not give additional access to Americans under the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement. Speaking of Subic, Clark, and Oyster Bay, which have not yet been opened up. Most likely, he will end any kind of offensive or amphibious exercises with the United States in the South China Sea. And if not mistaken, actually last week, he made, I think there was already, that was already translated into policy. So we may expect some slight downgrade or renegotiation of parameters of relations with the United States, but that doesn't necessarily mean that he's going to sever ties with the United States, because he has at least two problems, or I would say three problems. One is that if he severs ties with the United States, then the Philippines has minimal leverage when it deals with the giant with China. Because the problem in any bilateral negotiation is that when you have a big country like China and a small country like the Philippines, any bilateral engagement will be on China's terms. So you need the backup of US. The second reason is public opinion. Duterte is a very popular person. He has an 80% approval rating. But the US last year had a 92% approval rating. And later surveys suggest that US is still a very popular country. So if he severs ties entirely with the US, and that has that will have implications for the Philippine economy, that will have implications for migration from the Philippines to US, that could have impact on his political popularity. And the third factor, I think the most important factor, is the Philippine security establishment, which I think among all ASEAN countries is the most entwined with and dependent on the United States. So I think President Duterte realizes that he cannot sever the ties even if he wanted, because he faced these very serious obstacles. Nonetheless, the problem is that as far as reaching out to China, there could also be a ceiling. As Gregory a while ago mentioned, Philippines and China already have some sort of an arrangement in the Scarborough Shoal. So in the Scarborough Shoal, we have seen a provisional arrangement whereby Filipino fishermen are allowed, if I'm not mistaken, even enter the lagoon in the Scarborough Shoal based on certain reports that I have seen. But the problem is that this is an informal agreement. And there's no assurance that China will give long-term concessions to the Philippines in the Scarborough Shoal. The other problem is this, which I think is a more serious problem, is this. Not only is public opinion against China, the Philippine security establishment is also very suspicious of China. And above all, the arbitration award in July made it very clear that Philippines and China do not have any overlapping exclusive economic zone. So if the Philippines and China legally have no overlapping exclusive economic zone, and China is claiming majority of the Philippines' exclusive economic zone, where do you get the compromise here? And a lot of Filipinos are expecting the country to move forward with exploration and exploitation of potentially hundreds of billions of dollars of fishery resources and oil and gas resources within the Philippines' exclusive economic zone, including the Reed Bank. And if China will not give the Philippines any long-term concessions, any formal agreement in the area, it will be very difficult for Duterte to maintain his tilting towards China, to maintain this engagement with China. And it's very possible after a year or so, Duterte will have to recalibrate his foreign policy and hedge back to the United States. Especially if his popularity goes down, sometimes you need to rally around the flag in a very anti-China country. But I think the elephant in the room, and I'm gonna wrap this up, and I look forward to the question and answer portion, because we can go on forever on this issue, is the elephant in the room is not ASEAN. Although I disagree with my friend Ivan, I think ASEAN is the obligation of ASEAN to make sure at least we have a robust crisis management mechanism in the South China Sea. And the very fact that ASEAN even failed to mention the Philippine arbitration case and never showed significant amount of support for the Philippines under the previous administration says a lot about how the ASEAN is losing its way and not stepping up to the plate. I think the elephant in the room is not also China. The elephant in the room, without a question, is the United States. What kind of U.S. are we going to see under Donald Trump? In the past few days in New York, I saw nothing but protest every other day. We're going to see a much more polarized U.S. most likely. And we're going to see a United States that is more focused on its internal problems. We saw a revolt by the white working class who have brought Trump to power. And these people expect certain major reforms at home, from the Obamacare to the Immigration Act, among others. So we may see a much more neo-isolationist or introverted America. And the other problem is this, even if Trump wants to have a more proactive foreign policy for US, what kind of Donald Trump are we gonna see? Is this the Donald Trump that gave a gracious victory speech, or is it Donald Trump that we saw during campaign period and we often see on his Twitter account? And this will have huge implications for the region. So just to wrap it up, I think a Donald Trump that is a negotiator is good and bad. Because if Donald Trump wants a grand bargain with China to get concessions on free trade and business, that could mean that he's willing to make give concessions on the South China Sea. But at the same time, if Donald Trump is an aggressive bully, then that could also mean an unwanted escalation in the region, and we don't know how much experience and how much strategic patience he has in order to deal with the issue. From a positive standpoint, if Donald Trump is going to be a negotiator and a pragmatic person, he may actually contribute to dying down of tensions in the South China Sea. And if Donald Trump is perhaps the aggressive bully, for some people that's a good thing, because that means that finally there's going to be some meat put to the substance of pivot to Asia, because under the Obama administration we have seen more rhetoric than substance. Perhaps under Donald Trump we're going to see more aggressive American military footprint to check China's ambition. So on that note, thank you very much for your patience. Look forward to question and answer portion.
Just for the sake of it. Thank you, Richard Javadhidharian, for a spirited